Hello, everyone. My name is Lucy. So first things first, recently Vanessa Morgan spoke out about how the black characters of Riverdale are mistreated and written and treated like non-substantial sidekicks to the white characters. And honestly, it's about time she said that, because I've been thinking that for a long time. And I've actually been planning on making this video for a long time, so I guess now is as good a time as any to make it. But before I get into the main meat of this video though, I just want to let you know that I'm going to be leaving some resources, some petitions, some places to donate in the description down below in support of the Black Lives Matter movement, in support of justice for George Floyd, Breonna Taylor. It's important that we say their names, continue to educate ourselves, listen and learn and look for more ways of what you can do and how you can help. So thank you so much, and make sure to refer to the resources that I left down below if you don't know where to start. All right, let's get into this. This video is not going to be just about racial issues about the show either. It's going to be about a bunch of really problematic and discriminatory things that Riverdale has been doing for a while. A little disclaimer. These are not stupid things in the show that make me laugh, like Edgar's rocket or that one guy who dropped out in the fourth grade to run drugs to support his nana. No. These are straight up problematic things about the show that boil my blood, honestly, and I think need more attention. Now, I know that the title says that nobody talks about these issues. I'm just gonna start with the issues really fast that a lot of people actually do talk about or whatever, and then later in the video I'm gonna talk more about the issues that I don't see anybody talking about. Now, first and foremost, the main issue that is getting obviously most of the heat right now is the racism in the show. And a lot of it is centering around Vanessa Morgan because she's the one who came forward and spoke up. And yes, I think her character is absolutely treated like garbage in the show, but hers is not the only one. And we're gonna talk about Vanessa's character Tony a little bit later, but besides Josie and Tony, there are so many other black characters in the show that were either treated very poorly or forgotten about and thrown away. And let me tell you, most of them were forgotten about and thrown away. Season one had decent representation, but none of those characters are in the show anymore. Season one had a black woman as the mayor of Riverdale, which I thought was really cool. It had Josie and the Pussycats. It had Principal Weatherby. It had Chuck Clayton. Season one, you could tell they were really trying to make sure that this isn't just a white show, because I'm gonna tell you right now, all of those characters in the comics are white, except for Valerie and Chuck. And that was something that I thought was really cool. But where are all those characters now? Mayor McCoy is gone, Josie and the Pussycats are gone, Chuck Clayton is gone, Monroe, it looks like, is gone, and Principal Weatherby is gone. And he was replaced by a white principal who was, while he was cutthroat, a better principal. But even if you disregard the serious downgrade in representation as the show has gone on, if you think about it, these characters are often stereotyped and offensively mistreated. A couple of examples of these racial stereotypes: in The Midnight Club, Hermione said that her mom was a cleaning lady. Sierra was called the political animal in The Midnight Club. Yikes. The two new characters of color that were introduced this past season are Jughead's two Stonewall classmates, Joan and Jonathan, but they didn't do anything. Jughead had four Stonewall prep classmates, but Brett and Donna were the important ones with any storylines or even lines. Joan and Jonathan were literally just props. They only maybe said two sentences all season. And not only that, Jonathan got murdered and nobody cared! Like, when Betty comes to confront Donna, she says, well, you don't deserve to get away scot-free by almost killing my boyfriend. But they actually killed Jonathan. Does anybody care? No. The last racial stereotype or mistreatment in the show that I'm going to address is that of Chuck Clayton. Now, back in season one, I wasn't a big fan of the fact that they chose the black guy to be the guy that took advantage of a bunch of women, but I let it slide because Jason and a couple of other people were doing it too, and because, again, season one had decent or at least better representation than the show does now. But if you have read the Archie comics, you will know that Chuck Clayton is nothing like they portrayed him in the show. Everybody says that Jughead is the most warped character from the comics, and yeah, I agree, I think he's the most warped regular character, but out of all the characters, I think Chuck is the most warped. If you've read the comics, you'll know that they portray Chuck Clayton as a nice, kind black guy. And this was a pretty radical thing, because this was happening throughout the 60s and 70s. And he wasn't a player either in the comics. In the comics, he had one steady girlfriend, Nancy. They're probably the most stable relationship that is in the comics. And Nancy is another character that they decided not to have in the show. I'm just saying, Riverdale is quite problematic when it comes to racial issues, especially today. The next issue about Riverdale that we're going to talk about that, again, I think is actually addressed pretty frequently is the over-sexualization of teenage girls. Now, a few months ago, I think it was Netflix UK's Instagram account. I don't know, Netflix has too many Instagram accounts. But I think it was Netflix UK on Instagram posted this picture of Madeline, Lily, and Camila, and they said something like, I'm thankful for these three women, they're great, talented, whatever, that's not the issue. And somebody commented something like, yeah, and they're over-sexualized in the show that they're in as teenage girls. And Netflix UK, like, went off. They commented this long reply that says basically like, well, girls can be open about their sexuality and not be ashamed about it, and there's more to these girls' characters than their sexuality. Like, Betty is working at the newspaper, Cheryl's the class president, Veronica's a boss business lady, and who says that these girls have to be shamed by being open about their sexuality? And I agree with that, absolutely, but it doesn't make any sense in the context at all, because in the show, Betty does a striptease in front of a bunch of 40-year-old dudes in a bar as a minor. Cheryl lifts up her skirt and like shakes her hips during a cheerleading routine in front of bleachers full of people who are there to see a football game. Cheryl, Tony, and the River Vixens tried to seduce Mr. Honey by singing Sugar Daddy to him at Pops. And I have one thing to say about that queerphobic line. Don't act like it's the same thing as in Hedwig. Because yes, the original song was Hedwig or Hansel during his relationship with Luther. And it's empowering in that way. But don't even try to act like that is the same thing as a bunch of teenagers sexually dancing for their principal and calling him a sugar daddy. Mr. Honey disapproving of that performance is not homophobic. And Veronica does a bunch of sexual routines too, where she does a lot of like stripper-esque moves at her speakeasy. So Netflix UK, whoever typed that, don't even try to defend Riverdale on over-sexualizing teenagers, because being open about your sexuality and not being ashamed of it is different than portraying a minor stripping and pole dancing in front of a bunch of 40-year-olds. Okay, the last thing that I think that people talk about fairly often is Jughead's asexuality. Now, I remember when this show first came out, and there was a lot of people who were excited about Jughead or anticipating what's Jughead's character gonna be like? Is he gonna be asexual? Or there were gonna be asexual representation in this new teen drama? And it was announced that he's not going to be. He's going to be straight, romantic, heterosexual. Now, if you've seen any other Riverdale-related video of mine, you will know that I don't like Bughead. I think that they don't have any chemistry. I resent it because I think that Jughead should be strictly not attracted to anyone at all. And I think that Betty should be with Archie, but that's beside the point. And it would be one thing if he tried dating Betty at the beginning, but he was figuring out his identity and it had the potential to change. Now, 4 seasons into this show, clearly that's not gonna happen because Bughead was really, really popular and the Bughead fans, not all of them, but the loudest Bughead fans are incredibly toxic and send people death threats and threaten to give the show low ratings. Now, recently, Roberto, the creator of Riverdale, said that the writers don't actually listen to what the fans say and that they kind of block that all out and just write whatever they think is best. That's straight up bullcrap. If that was true, they wouldn't have had the exact same couples for the last 4 seasons because everybody knows teen dramas categorically spice things up and have different couples and there are breakups and makeups and love triangles. Like, that's just part of the genre. And Riverdale is botching it because of the fans and because the writers know it. And even if it was true and the writers did ignore the fans, that would mean that they would have absolutely no excuse not to be true to Jughead's character. So yeah, the fact that the media has very, very little asexual representation, and the fact that the Archie comics literally have a character that is canonically asexual since 2016, and the fact that they completely rid his character of that and make him another straight guy, it's problematic. It is. Okay, so now we're getting a little bit more into the things that I don't hear talked about quite as much. And we're gonna start off that list with homophobia and biphobia. First and foremost, we're gonna talk about Kevin. Kevin is the stereotypical gay best friend. And there are moments, especially in the earlier seasons, where it's cute. But since then, Kevin has gotten absolutely no development and growth as a character. Still, 4 seasons into this show, Kevin has one predominant character trait. Gay. Think of Kevin's character. Think of him. What word comes to mind? Gay. That's it. Really, that's it. Now, I think it's great that Kevin is accepted by everybody in the town, especially since it's a small town, but it would be nice to see him have more qualities about his character, get some development, nice character arc, because the show treats him horribly. In this day and age, Kevin should be able to freely and openly explore his sexuality, but the show, for some reason, does not want this to happen. The show has proven to prevent this from happening by putting Kevin constantly in questionable situations, such as the cruising and, of course, the tickle porn. Okay, at the beginning of the video, I said that we were gonna talk about Tony later. We're gonna talk about it right now. Cheryl and Tony. While Cheryl and Tony are relatively present in the show, they don't do anything important to the plot. Like Jason's dead body, that doll in Cheryl's house, whatever they did at Thanksgiving, none of that was relevant at all to the overall arc of the story and will probably be forgotten about by the end of the summer. But yeah, while Cheryl and Tony are relatively present, they don't do anything important or relevant to the plot. And they're mostly just shown off in the advertisements or the promotional photos and videos to show diversity and to show that the show has a gay couple. Now we're gonna delve more specifically into Tony, which is the biphobia bit. We've gotten to the point where Tony acts like Cheryl's sidekick, not her girlfriend. Cheryl is the only person that Tony talks to. She's the only person that she has any conversations or storylines with. And Tony adjusts to Cheryl's every need and every move. And she agrees with Cheryl about everything, even when Cheryl is wrong. And not only that, Tony is the most sexualized character in the show, I think. The most offensive portrayal of Tony's character is, I would say, in the Heathers episode when she drags Sweet Pea and Peaches on the stage to have a threesome with them. And it's very sexual, very stereotypical. It really feeds into that generalization that bisexual people are these like over the top sexual characters who want to do it with anybody that crosses their path and who want to be with a boy and a girl at the same time. That's not true. And looking at the way Tony's character is written and the way she's dressed and the way she behaves specifically in that Heathers episode, that could lead a uneducated person to think that that's what bisexual people are like. The last biphobic thing I'm going to talk about this show is simply their refusal to say the word bisexual. After Tony has that one night stand with Jughead, she just says, "I'm more into girls anyways." When Jughead walks in on Moose and Donna, Moose says, "I like guys and girls." This show, for the representation that it has, uses most of the words that represent that representation. This show, in its writing, has used the word gay, it's used the word lesbian, it's used the word straight. It has never used the word bisexual, which I don't know why. It's not like it's a swear word, and it's not like it means anything negative. So just use the word. Writers don't say, "I go both ways," or "I like guys and girls." Just, you can say the word, bisexual, it's okay. Now the next thing I'm going to talk about, which is really more of a character thing, but it's Cheryl's personality in seasons 3 and 4. This one is not going to take that long. Now in seasons 1 and 2, I actually liked Cheryl. I liked that she was deranged. I liked that she was, for lack of a better term, a bitch. I liked that she treated people badly because people treated her badly. And for anybody who doesn't know, Cheryl is indeed a deranged and kind of horrible person in the comics. But in seasons 3 and 4, she has literally not changed. She still does all these horrible things, calls people names, invades people's privacy, gets into other people's business, takes a picture of Betty and Archie and sends it to the whole school. It's not even her place to do that. Now in season 1 or the beginning of season 2, this might have made a little bit more sense. She still had a lot of growth to do. But even after she is confirmed to be happy with Tony, the babies, and Nana Rose, she still acts the same way. She still treats people badly, and she still acts like she's better than everybody else. The next problematic thing about Riverdale is the main characters defying reasonable authority. Now, this mostly happened in season 4. Now, I get it, in teen dramas and even at the beginning of Riverdale, a great majority of the adults are in the wrong because you're supposed to side with the kids. This has happened in TV show after TV show, except Riverdale season 4 is when it started to really get problematic for this show. Because it got to the point where the authority is more in the right than the kids. I'm not going to say that Mr. Honey wasn't cutthroat and could be mean, because he absolutely could have been. But, and I've been saying this all season, he is the principal that school needed. He actually had authority and punished students that were doing the wrong thing. And a lot of those punishments were not unjust. Let me tell you, posting tickle porn in your school uniforms, lifting up your skirt during a cheerleading routine, locking a coach in her office, that is the wrong thing to do. And he actually punished students who weren't good kids. And newsflash, Riverdale characters, that's what a principal is for. That's what boiled my blood on that Killing Mr. Honey episode, where they're talking about, like, yeah, Principal Honey has been punishing us. He's been on our case. It's gotta be a personal grudge. And I'm like, no, you broke rules. And he's a principal. And principals punish students who break rules. Wow. And yes, I'm aware that he had conversations with Reggie, with Archie, with Jughead about their education and how they might not be able to graduate. But honestly, he's cutthroat, but he's honest. He's brutally honest. That's what you call it. I'm not gonna say that he wasn't mean, not gonna say that he didn't make mistakes, but he was a good principal. At least better than Principal Weatherby or any other authority figure in the show. The other episode that really, really just boiled my blood about the defiance of really reasonable authority is the episode that Coach Appleyard was in. That lady was great. First of all, the fact that the River Vixens had a coach, it was such a huge deal for Cheryl, and she said, you know, I gotta run the show around here, but most high school teams have a coach. Like, if you're an organized high school team or club and you don't have a coach or a supervisor, something's not right. Fun fact, I actually thought when I was first watching the show, when I was first watching season one, I thought it was weird that the cheerleaders didn't have a coach. I was kept thinking, like, where's the coach? The captain's not in charge. The coach is supposed to be in charge. And they brought in a coach, and this coach seemed to genuinely be a great coach. She has taken her team to nationals 3 years in a row. She said that we're going to be doing cheers, because this is a cheerleading team, and we're not going to be singing and dancing to pop songs and doing stripper moves anymore. She was well within her rights to say all of that. All right, sorry for the sudden change in location. But anyway, she was well within her rights to say all of that. And when she did, I actually was like, girl, thank you. So Miss Appleyard is being a good cheer coach. She wants to focus on the cheering. And she encourages the cheerleaders to do drills and all that great stuff. Cheryl, on the other hand, insults her, says she should be the laundrywoman, says to her coach, am I hallucinating or did you just give me an order? Calls the Vixens names, yells at the Vixens, locks Miss Appleyard in her office, and lifts up her skirt. Tell me again how people root for Cheryl. I'd really like to know. In any other school, in any normal school, she would have been suspended and kicked off the cheerleading team for that. The next thing is the insane general double standards. Now, these double standards, I don't really hear anybody talk about. The first thing is something that I already mentioned in one of my reaction videos, the tickle porn.
How about the Vixens tickle the Bulldogs exclusively? And that way the girls will be in charge. Like it should be.
Okay, I get it. It's supposed to be empowering, but no gender should be in charge. What happened to equality? Like, if the boys were doing this to the girls, it would be such an uprising. But if, you know, the girls doing it to the boys, totally acceptable and fine. But the more prominent thing I'm gonna touch on here is how badly Veronica treated Reggie in season three. Now, you had better believe that was a double standard. Let's go through that here, okay? Veronica is Reggie's boss. He does everything that she asks him to do, and then they start dating. Except it means more to Reggie than it does to Veronica. Veronica just kind of thinks of Reggie as a casual hookup and as an errand boy. She straight up used him for sex. And the minute that Archie comes back to Riverdale, who is the person that she would rather be with, she just expects Reggie to drop their entire relationship so she can be with Archie again. I'm sorry, if any man did that to a woman, it would be such an outrage. He would be one of the most disliked characters on the show, I guarantee it. But since Veronica did it, it's okay. And nobody ever talks about it anymore. And everybody loves her and everybody thinks she's the best. No, she's not. Why? Because of the insane double standard of this show. The next few things are just gonna be short little thoughts that are really messed up about the show, but I don't have a whole lot of analysis on it. Some of those things include kids and adults dancing up on each other and a lot of sexual innuendos between them. The first thing that comes to mind is Cheryl and Tony and Hermosa in the club, Veronica's Oedipus complex, Dark Betty, Alice's redemption as an FBI agent. The bottom line is, she got forgiven way too easily. She still put Betty through hell. She sold the house. She burnt all of their family photos. She gave away Betty's college money. And after she was redeemed, she just let Polly stay in a mental asylum without even so much as talking about her or seeing if she's okay or if she's better. And she says that she loves Betty more, which is seriously messed up. There's the fact that Donna lied about her affair with Mr. Chipping, which I get in that context. It's clear that she lied and she had a reason for covering it up because she's a murderer. But if you look at the bigger picture, it's extremely problematic. Because domestic violence and being taken advantage of by someone who has power over you are serious issues. Donna came forward and told a story about how she was abused by her teacher. It turned out that she was lying. And that is also a serious issue. Now, I get that in the context of the show, there was very good reason for not believing Donna. But women who come forward and say that they were attacked and people thinking that they're lying is a huge problem in our society right now. And Riverdale is literally feeding that by having a teenage girl lie about her abuse. And finally, the actors are not the characters. I wanted to stay away from critiquing the Riverdale fandom because that's a whole other video that I probably won't do, but it's insanely toxic how much people hate these actors for the things that their characters do on television. Guys, the people who play the characters that you hate, they're not really like that. Vanessa Morgan doesn't really want to break Cole and Lily up when Tony kissed Jughead. Just because two people are dating in a show doesn't mean that they would be compatible or should date in real life, or are dating in real life. And just because Shannon Purser's character kissed Jughead does not give people any right to fat shame her or to say that she's a bad actress. So there you have it. Those are the horrible things about Riverdale that not enough people talk about. Thank you ever so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please, if you can, like it and leave a comment down below, maybe telling me other problematic things about Riverdale that I may have missed. I know there must be some things, so I welcome your input. This is also my invitation to you to subscribe to my channel for more videos like this, and some of them are, I promise, much more fun than this. And from the bottom of my heart, I hope that you have a wonderful, amazing day, and thank you for watching. Bye!